Today's episode is sponsored by the 29 Toes Podcast. If at any point during this episode you find yourself a little too uncomfortable and triggered, you can head over to 29toes.com and kind of decompress your brain a little bit, where they're just having casual, laid-back, fun, funny conversations about things that are going on in their lives, in the world, things in media and entertainment, all that fun stuff. So check them out at 29toes.com or wherever podcasts are sold. The following is a Goulash Media production. GoulashMedia.net.
Welcome to the system is down.
Well, holy moly and hallelujah, downers. Welcome back to another fantastic episode of the least comfortable show on the web. You know the name, you know the place, it's The System is Down. This is the place where we talk about all the uncomfortable topics, the things that get your panties in a wad, the not politically correct issues. We do so in a civil manner, but this is the place where you come if you are offended by people who get offended by things, because there is literally nothing that is off the table. And if you're new here, welcome to the show. It's a pleasure to have you. Go find the person who invited you. Give them a big hashtag me too, kiss on the mouth and a slap on the rear from you and me, because I appreciate you being here, and I know that you're going to enjoy it just as much, if not more, than I will. And if you're one of the many people who tune into the show every single Monday morning for your weekly dose of discomfort, welcome back. It's always a pleasure. I know that you're going to enjoy this episode, because this one is my conversation that I had with the great Johnny Rocket Adams from Launchpad Media. And we talked all about, well, we actually got off on a lot of rabbit trails, to be completely honest, but the main focus was how art influences people and influences and impacts the world. It was a great conversation. I loved having it. Johnny's a great guy, and he was a real fun time to hang out and chat with him. So stick around for that. Before we jump into that, I'll remind you guys real quick about the Downers Club, which is our patron program. You can support the show on Patreon by going to patreon.com/thesystemisdown, signing up for as little as $5 a month. And in doing so, you'll get a bunch of free bonus audio and video content every single week, including extended interviews with guests. We do game shows with Remzo Martinez. We do Would You Rather Wednesday. We do extended episodes of the Anti-News and a whole bunch more fun stuff. So go check that out at patreon.com/thesystemisdown and be a part of something bigger than yourself. Also, got to remind you guys about the second show on this channel that we do every single week. Craig and I do the Anti-News, which is where we basically go over things that are happening in the world in a dark, comedic fashion. If you hate the news, if you hate watching the news, and you don't necessarily want to know, you kind of want to know what's going on in the world, but you really just want to listen to guys bullshit and bash on news articles and things that are happening, then check out Anti-News. It comes out every Wednesday morning. That is the other show on this stream, and you can check that out right now by going to antinewslive.com. Or just check it out wherever you're listening to this. But let's jump into this. Again, this is my conversation with the great Johnny Rocket Adams. That's it. That's it for this intro. So I'll see you guys on the other side of the episode. Let's get weird. My guest today is artist, author, musician, podcaster, and creator of Launchpad Media, Johnny Rocket Adams. Johnny, how's it going, man?
Good, man. How you doing, man?
I'm doing fantastic. And Johnny, you and I run in some of the same circles, but our paths have never officially crossed until now. So it's a pleasure to see your beautiful face on this wonderful Saturday morning. And
I know. Thank you.
Yeah, I think 10 o'clock there, 11 o'clock here, and I hit you up and said, hey, you know, if you want to bring a drink, if it's not too early, it's Saturday. Screw it. So what are you drinking over there, Johnny?
What is it?
Lagunitas?
Lagunitas. Yeah. Hop stupid.
Nice.
I'm actually drinking a hop beer. I usually don't, but I've sort of gotten into them.
Sure.
As of recent, because I was like a shitty beer drinker forever.
Yep.
And I don't know if this is like a PG-13 show or I can swear. I don't know.
Go for it. You can say whatever you want.
Okay. Okay, so Lagunitas hop stupid, and it's 8% alcohol.
Nice.
So I'm like pretty excited about it, man. It's pretty good. It's
So when I like, said, again, bring I a drink, you weren't fucking around. You're like, I'm just going straight to the top.
That's right.
Going for the 8% at 10 bucks. In the morning.
That's right. It's 10 a.m. And I, again, it's the weekend, so I don't really buy into the whole rule thing where it's like, it has to be noon.
Right.
It's bullshit. Whatever.
What difference does it make? If I'm going to drink at noon, I'm just going to drink faster anyway. But
exactly.
So is that Lagunitas? Is that an IPA? Are you an IPA man or not?
It's I have IPA in the fridge, but this is just the real hoppy version of it. Yeah, it is. I think it is a, yeah. Yeah. It is an IPA.
I know Lagunitas does a couple different IPAs, but yeah, that's good to know.
It's just like our good super. Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty good. I'm actually enjoying it. And it's just like, again, like what I was saying, man, Miller Lite and the shitty beers were my thing forever. And then finally, now that I've been my fiance, Miss Kimberly Ruff, she's like, you got to start drinking some real beer. None of that bullshit. So I'm like, all right. So then I started kind of drinking it and I'm like, yeah, it's not too bad. Yep. It's not too bad. I like it, actually.
Absolutely. Yeah, I'm drinking a Dogfish Head 60-minute IPA, so similar. There you similar go. Stuff. Good choice. Yeah. I know the Lions of Liberty guys are all pussies over there and can't handle the man beer, but, you know, it's nice to find a fellow IPA drinker.
Well, now I am, apparently, because I've been buying it, and it's been like, it's changed my mind about everything. This beer in particular, because I usually don't like IPAs, but this is really good.
Perfect. Well, we're actually not here to talk about beer as much as I would enjoy doing a full hour of that, but
yeah,
we're here to talk about art and influence and you, primarily you, sir. So I always like to start out getting a little bit of background on people, whether or not it weighs into where they're at now in life, doesn't matter. I just like, you know, knowing where you come from and everything. So tell me a little bit about yourself, man.
Well, I guess Well, I'm from Illinois, from where you're at right now, outside of Chicago.
The other part of Illinois.
I joined the military. What's that?
I said the other part of Illinois. Yeah.
Yeah, the southern part, wherever no one knows where any of the, you know, you say Peoria and they go Peoria, Illinois. No, yeah. I'm in Peoria, Arizona.
Nice.
But yeah, so I guess it started in high school for me and on the outskirts of Chicago. And I started drawing a comic book called John Boy Comics in high school. And I had a great experience doing it. I actually made like $2,000 when I was like 16 years old and I sold them to all my friends. And I thought it was kind of cool. It's like everyone knew me as like one of the most, you know, I was voted the most artistic in my high school class and all that jazz. And then eventually I kind of gave that up because I was broke and living out of my car. And I remember those were pretty tough times. And I was just like, I didn't know anything really about politics. So I was like, you know what, let me just join the military. I think this would be a good idea. And so then after getting yelled at and screamed at for about 3 or 4 months, I went to Korea and, you know, started getting into music and started really, while I was in the military, I started like studying music theory and bands and jazz and rock and roll and all these different times or genres of music. So that, I guess the military was to blame for my musical, you know, my knowledge of music as it is now.
Don't hear that too often, but cool.
No, I know. It was just like the stuff that like made me sane at the end of the day. You know, it's like I had to deal with all this like
your therapy,
left, right? You know, it was my therapy. Exactly, dude. And so I was in the military and then finally I started getting really good at it. And I figured, you know, I'd do this helicopter flying thing. This seems like a good idea. And so I went to flight school and I became a pilot for the Army. I was a air cavalry. And I was reconnaissance, and I did that for about 4 or 5 years. I got out as a CW2 chief warrant, and I said, this is enough. And I got out of the military because I just didn't like not knowing what I was going to do the next day.
Sure.
And I finally said, I just got to get out. So I did get out, and I got into music. I started my band, the Hot Rod and Romeos, about 2006, 2007. And I started getting into this rockabilly music, this rockabilly scene.
Nice.
Hot rods, pinup girls, that old jazz.
Right on.
And tattoos. And yeah, exactly. So it was cool. It was fun. And it was a party every night. It was like I started writing songs and I had my buddies in the band. And we'd just party every night and had a blast. And eventually I found this thing called libertarianism. And
all downhill
from there,
right?
Cool. So it was downhill, man. And so, yeah, so the band ended up breaking up after 10 years. We broke up around 2016. And it was a sad day when that happened. There's another long story about that, why that happened. But I started doing a podcast called The Johnny Rocket Launchpad with my previous girlfriend, Heather Nixon, and my buddy, Kurt Nelson. I went to college for audio and video at the Art Institute and got my bachelor's in that. And I just kept going forward with the radio show or the podcast. And I was on multiple radio stations, and I still am on majority of them. And I figured there's got to be something bigger than just a podcast. And I wanted to influence culture because I believe that is where people's philosophies start. And where people, you know, with modern day culture, everything is really affected by art and music and movies and all those mediums.
Right.
And I wanted to maybe use my philosophy and start incorporating the libertarian philosophy into those forms of art and music and all that other stuff. So that's why I started Launchpad Media. And this is where I'm at now, just starting it.
Sure. Yeah. Good stuff. Now, backpedal a little bit. Tell me a little bit more about this. The thing that most caught my attention was the comic book that you did when you were 16. What exactly was that? Was it just like a superhero typical thing, or was it something unique?
Yeah, it was kind of a spoof on Spider-Man.
Nice.
It was like a joke comic. I started just drawing. I like Spider-Man and I like the X-Men, and it was a stupid story about my character, and instead of like getting bitten by a radioactive spider, he microwaves some food in the micro, you know, is microwaving some food, and there was a spider in it, and it falls in his food, and that's how he had spider powers. So it was ridiculous. It was complete nonsense comic, but it was fun. I enjoyed it. People, and you know, chicks dug the art, so I enjoyed doing it.
Yeah. And did you do all the writing, the illustrations, and everything at that time?
Yeah, everything.
Nice.
Yeah, cool. I had this weird idea and I just went with it. And next thing you know, I was producing them and I was selling them for $3 back in 1993. And I sold a whole bunch of them. I probably around 200-300 of them.
Right. Nice.
So I made quite a bit of money for a kid. Yeah.
Very cool. In doing the bands and all the stuff throughout the military time and all that, what was your area of expertise as far as like what instruments and what avenues did you go down?
Well, I played drums when I was a kid forever. When I was a kid, I just loved the drums. That was I just loved the way they look.
Sure.
And now being in the music business for a while, you understand that being a drummer sucks because you have to carry all that shit around.
That's right.
So I said, no, I don't want to do that. But
that's why I played guitar
for a little bit. that's what I ended up doing is I was influenced kind of by my mom because she worked with like Count Basie, Tina Turner back in the 60s and stuff like that.
Very cool.
And when she was a kid, so she worked with some really big names like Chicago, Pizza Terra. Who else? God, The Killer. A whole bunch of famous people now that were like, wow, these people are legends. And she was in the mix with all those people. And she was making great money back in the day. So I kind of followed her footsteps in the music side. And so, yeah, I did the vocals and I started writing lyrics and I had melodies in my head and I had to go to the guitar player. Can you play this? And you go, you mean like this? I'm like, yeah, I think an E.
That's still how I do it. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So you write songs by like, this is the melody. And he's like, okay, I got it. So, yeah, that's how I wrote songs. And it was hilarious. And then like, how about the bridge? You know, we'd come up with these ideas about that. So it was a very informal way of writing music, but it worked.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we got a lot of good gigs from it.
Very cool. Very cool. And so you go through all this process of learning all this stuff while you're in the military. It's kind of your therapy. You said that you went through, college professional training and everything in was it the arts or was it just in music specifically or remind me what you said?
Oh, it was like it was like the technical side. It was a lot of mixing. It was a blend of electronics, a blend of mixing, a blend of understanding signal flow, compressors, preamps. Just basic recording, front of house, doing sound design, engineering mostly. And but there was a lot of a big focus in on the electronics and video. So it was kind of a mishmash of everything. So cool. I didn't even know they had a degree for that.
Right.
But they did. So I'm like, cool. Well, let me do that. So I got my degree and then I figured out that all that's theft. Most of my GI Bill is theft. And so I want to thank all the American people for paying for my education that I did not earn. And I'm an asshole for that.
Sure, yeah. Sure. A little bit of a hypocrite, but it's fine. So that kind of leads pretty well into my next question of, do you see value in going into you know, getting an education for art or for engineering, stuff like that? Or do you see it more as something that you should be going through like a trade school or an internship or something for?
I don't think, no, not really.
Do you think the taxpayer dollars were well spent is my question here.
Well, it was a private school, but again, I had the GI Bill, so I could, it really wasn't a strong, staunch libertarian. I didn't understand the concepts of it at the time or my political belief system. Now looking back, I wouldn't have done it. And do I see a value in it? It was valuable, but it was nothing that I could have figured all of that out on my own by watching YouTube videos, really, if I needed to, you know. So was it necessary? No. It was just kind of a thing. I think, you know, more or less the college degree, in my opinion, is more of like, can you stick with something for 4 years?
Sure.
And that's all it proves, is that you can stick with something. It's not really what you learn. It's that you just did something and you weren't forced to do it for 4 years.
Right.
And you just did it on your own accord. So to me, that's the only value that you could possibly get out of it. I mean, again, I think it's overpriced. I think it was ridiculous. And I believe in certifications or private courses, or I don't believe that you should have any state government money involved in this. And of course, you know this already because I'm a libertarian, but this is not why we're here.
It's all good. It's all good. Let it flow.
Yeah. But again, like what I'm saying is no, I didn't really. I think I could have gotten the same education if I had the discipline to structure my life out personally. Sure. And I could have figured all of this out on my own. Gotcha. without any schooling. Absolutely.
Right on.
It's overrated.
Yeah. Now, since then, like you said, podcasting, radio, this and that. What do you feel kind of is your goal in life or your lot in life? Like, what is your purpose here in doing all this stuff? We talked a little bit about influencing and, using these artistic abilities to potentially influence people to think certain ways. Like, what's your kind of your take on that?
Well, I guess the major goal in what I want to do is, well, I could see the end result. I really want people to start embracing my ideas of my political philosophy. And I don't think that we can do it through politics necessarily. I think it's a multiple front operation. And I guess I'd be successful if I look up and there's a movie that says Launchpad Media on it and has like the creators of this awesome movie that everyone wants to see. That would be the ultimate goal, is doing a movie. Actual movie or documentary that's in theaters. Will that ever happen? I don't think so, but that would be success to me. But my main goal is to influence as many people as possible and do it through, you know, a way that's not necessarily academic.
Sure.
I think, you know, academics are awesome. I think it's a great way to learn things, but I think most people learn through popular culture, and that's the side. That's what I really want to do with Launchpad Media, is I want to start influencing people through comic books, through humor, through movies, through entertainment. I think that is what we're lacking. And the libertarian philosophy, I think, lacks the creative side. I really don't meet very many creative libertarians. So they're very studious. They're very logical. They're very smart people. But they lack that. And I think there's a very small few of us who are creative. And I think that we need to hone in and grab those people and utilize them to the best of our ability to get our message out there and find that talent wherever it may lie. Excuse me.
Sure.
So I think that's the most important thing that we need to do as libertarians or any political philosophy. I think is very important to be utilized in the medium or the media as of today. So this is where I think we're failing as a an ideology, is that we are not cool. We are not cool at all. And, you know, like, you see people and they're like, they look like bookworms. They're playing D&D and there's nothing wrong with D&D. I actually secretly love D&D.
Pocket protectors are still cool. Come on. Calculator watches.
Come on now. I'm with you. Yeah, sure. Fine. Whatever. Whatever you think is cool, but it's not really cool. It's cool to us, but it ain't cool to the average person, you know?
Sure.
And I think that is the problem, man. I mean, like, we are not cool. If you go to any libertarian convention or any libertarian event, you're like, oh my God, oh, I need a drink. And this is why I drink, Dan, be an ass man. Half the time I drink is because of these people. I tell you, I don't know.
It didn't used to drink at 10 o'clock in the morning on a Saturday, but you know, the Libertarian Party's brought it to you. So yeah,
no, I mean, and they don't drink at 10 o'clock. I'll tell you that they hardly all, none of them drink really that I've met. I mean, they're all like, oh, I got this new Mises book and I love Mises, by the way, but yeah, they're a bunch of characters. I'll tell you that.
Sure. That's their drug. Their drug is knowledge.
That's right.
Too much, but, you can a little bit. So, I mean, every political party, has different sects of people who are, you know, preaching about something or another. Do you think that, you know, if you are an influencer, if you have a voice in one way or another, do you think that it is kind of an obligation or like something that you should be doing? If you have like good solid points for your moral beliefs and you are also an influencer, should you be putting that out there?
Well, I think everyone should use whatever talents they have for the name of the cause they believe in. So, I mean, if you are, you know, I like to bullshit. That is my gift. I have the gift of gab. And so I enjoy talking to people. I think it's, you learn a lot, not necessarily by talking, but listening, but the interaction or the communication that's involved, the, you know, the question response, you can learn quite a bit. And I think it is kind of my duty. I feel as a personal duty. I don't believe anyone should force me to do that, but I feel like, it's my inherent duty to do what's right and to spread my beliefs. And this is the medium in which I enjoy doing. And it's the easiest and it's the quickest way to get the message out there. So we're, you know, like doing like the comic book that I've done, Liberty Force, that itself takes a while to get out and push and promote and do this. So it's not as immediate. So yes, it's very much a long process doing a comic book, but doing the radio is easy. It's like, bam. Next day shows out, you know? So to me, it's like, it's kind of a moral obligation on my end. Sure. It's a personal obligation that I need to do to spread the message. And there's a lot of great people who are doing stuff. You know, you got Mark Claire, you got Jason Stapleton, all these guys, Tom Woods, my hero. I mean, all these guys are going out there and kicking butt and taking names. I'm kicking ass and taking names. I'm not going to censor myself on your show. Fuck that. But
I appreciate it.
But what I'm saying is I think the reason that we're doing it is we have a moral obligation and we feel like what we're doing and what we're saying is actually influencing people. And it's maybe they don't buy into it 100%, but as long as there's that little nugget of information in the back of somebody's head, it's affecting their subconscious. Maybe that's going to somehow affect them later on in life, or you're planting the seed. If you're not going to change somebody overnight, that's fine. But as long as you plant the seed, I think that's also important.
Sure.
For future growth.
Yeah, absolutely. Do you agree with that statement for people of different beliefs, like Taylor Swift? Is she obligated to come out and support the Democrats, or is Kanye West obligated to come out and support Donald Trump or whatever? Do these people, since they have that influence and everything, and they do probably have deep-seated beliefs and things as far as how the country should be run, are they morally obligated to put that in their work? Or can they just be artists?
To judge. I mean, I think it's, if that's what they believe, I think they have the right to say it. And I have also the right to say they're a bunch of fucking retards. But other than that, I mean, they have the right to do it. And if they feel like what their messaging is right and moral and just, by all means, they should be able to do it. And they should use their influence and their talents and their art to express that. I'm just saying that our messaging or the libertarian messaging sucks, and not because of the logic behind it or the common sense behind it, but it's more or less like, you guys are not cool. I mean, we got like a few cool people on our team and that's about it. And those people are kind of like pushed under the rug once they do kind of make some headway.
Right.
And it pisses me off because we should be out there in the forefront promoting these ideas through mediums other than podcasts, which I'm guilty of. But, you know, like art, comic books. I mean, there's Jamie Sherman, who does The Voluntarist, Jack V. Lloyd, as most people know him as.
Sure.
And he started the whole Libertarian Voluntarist comic book series, which is great. I thought it was a great comic. And Jamie does a great job, and people like it. But the only thing is only libertarians like it. And it's not really appealing to the average person, and other libertarians are buying it.
Sure.
But the Joe Schmuckatelli down the street isn't.
It's preaching the choir.
And so this is where we need to... Exactly. So there's a need to preach to the choir, and I'm like, I'm all for it because
the choir is pretty screwed up. So feel free to preach to the choir too.
Yeah, exactly. I think the choir needs some like reassurance every once in a while that like what they're on is the right track.
We need some choir directors every now and then.
Exactly, dude. We do, and I think there's a need for that. But I think with a lot of things, and like, I think the best example of libertarianism in modern day culture, I was actually talking about this with Kim, is Captain America, the Captain America movies.
Sure.
They were great. That is like the most libertarian film I have ever seen. And I don't know how it got through the censors in Hollywood, but it did. Mm-hmm. And I was just like, wow, this is great. And so it's so subtle. But yet Captain America is such a badass, right. And yet it's so subtle that it just kind of, it went right past the, you know, progressive smell test right into, you know, right now it's like Captain America is a libertarian film. Holy shit. It actually happened. And it was by Marvel. Oops. Holy crap. You know, yeah, we need that. We need more of that. And I think this is what we're lacking. And, you know, that's my opinion. I just don't think that we don't have our finger on the pulse of what's cool.
Yeah.
And I think there's Eric July is another great example of a great artist. I I'm going to be honest. I'm not a huge fan of everything he does.
Sure.
But I love what he is doing and I will support it just because I love the ideas that he is trying to spread. I'm not like a huge rap guy. I don't know if you can tell. Maybe because I'm slightly Caucasian. I don't know.
Hey, but, I'm a huge rap guy. So, you know. No judgments, but
I'm not. But it's subjective. It's subjective.
I love backwards. So
it doesn't. No, but I love what he's doing, and I think it's imperative that he keeps doing it. And I will support him 100% through everything. I do like that one song he did. Never mind. But again, I think it's important that we have more Eric Julys out there.
Yeah.
We need more Eric Julys. There's Sama Ripa. And he's doing stuff right now. And we have plenty of libertarian musicians out there. Well, five. And
it's a big market.
Those five are doing everything they can to get themselves on the Billboard charts. But I don't know where that's going to go. I don't know.
Hey, Dan Smotz here. I'm taking a second to interrupt myself talking to talk about myself. Because, you know, I don't get paid a penny for the hours and hours that I put into creating this show for you guys in your greedy little ears. And I've got a family to feed. To make that happen, I run my own media business called Goulash Media. If you have a need in anything from video production to graphic design to audio production and beyond, you can get it all for a painfully fair price at Goulash Media. In video, I do weddings, music videos, commercials, pageants, plays, etc., etc., etc. For design, I do photo editing, album art, logos, branding, business cards, merchandise, you name it. For audio, I do engineering, production, editing, jingles, and, well, podcasts. So if you've got a media need of any kind, or if you'd just like to give a little something back and help keep my children fed, check out all the endless options at my website, goulashmedia.net. That's goulash, G-O-U-L-A-S-H, media.net, where we cater to the little guy with the big vision. Okay.
Yeah, and it's funny that you bring up Eric July and backwards, because I had heard that name in all the libertarian spheres and everything. Everybody talked about this band, and I never listened to it for the longest time. I didn't give it a chance because I'm like, I mean, I have an issue with the message taking precedent over the art. Like, I feel like the art has to come first, especially if you're trying to influence people. Like, it has to be good to begin with. And then we can start peppering in some things about what we believe and that type of thing. And I come from a hardcore conservative Christian upbringing where it was all Christian rock and this and that, and it's all cheesy garbage. It's like libertarians are the Christian rock generally of of the political world.
Yes.
So
yes.
I was skeptical on Eric July stuff because I'm like, if all these libertarians are ranting about it, it's probably not good art. And then I finally gave it a chance.
Right,
was very
yeah.
pleased to find out otherwise.
Dude, you nailed it, man. That's a perfect analogy there. Yeah, you're right, man. It's like, yeah, they put the message in front of the art. And again, you can destroy, like, that's why Christian rock never made the top 10.
Right.
Like, if it was like a really, really good song, no, everyone would just kind of skip over the lyrics.
Right.
My mom, she's the best a very ones, religious person.
The best ones, yeah, the ones that actually do make the charts are the ones that don't shove it down your throat. They put out good art.
Exactly.
And then over time, you start to get some of their messaging. You start to pick up things here and there. And you're like, is that a Christian? Oh, okay. I mean,
exactly,
it's cool because they're good.
Yeah, that's a great point, man. It's like, so my mom, we were, you know, she loved that song by Steve Winwood. I don't know how old you are, but there was a song called Higher Love
okay.
by Steve Winwood. And it was like a big hit back in 1987,
that's
right?
A year before I was born.
Yeah, but it was a huge hit.
Yeah.
And, but if you really listen to the song, it was like on the top 10. But if you really listen to the lyrics, I'm not a religious person by any stretch of the imagination,
sure.
but it was about God. If
yeah.
you really listen to the lyrics, but it wasn't presented in that way. It was kind of like, it could be taken as a romance. It could be taken as,
right.
but if you really listen to it, it's, she was like, I think this song is really about God. I'm like, wow. Okay, cool.
Sure.
But he did it. Mission accomplished. But that's, it shouldn't be the focal point. It should be just the art needs to come first. You nailed it, dude. You nailed it. This is why Stryper sucked in 1987 with their, you know, they tried to be a heavy metal band, a Christian rock band. Yeah.
Sure.
And no one listened to them. Like, why? Except for the Christian people, right?
Right.
And that was it. Like, I'm only authorized to listen to Stryper, you know? Like, dude. And it was terrible. Like, I didn't like it because I was like, God loves me. You know, it's like, no, that's not.
Yeah, I
no,
never got into hair cool, metal, dude. Be it secular or Christian, so.
Yeah, it was, well, that was my gig, dude. I probably got like 10, 12 years on you, so.
It's all right.
But, yeah.
I'll like the rap. You can represent the hair metal.
No, I don't represent the hair metal, man. I'm a rockabilly guy. So, like, I'm all about the Stray Cats and the pompadours and the,
right.
the hot rods and all that stuff. But, I mean, seriously, you're right, though. I think you nailed that statement perfectly. It's, yeah, you got to put the art first. And that was the problem with the Atlas Shrugged movies.
Right.
Like, really, it was really bad.
I haven't like seen them, but I've heard that it I mean, it sounds the way people describe it sounds like, you know, it comes off of a great book that everybody, I mean, a great message book that everybody loves in a certain genre. And it sounds like the Christian movies that come out and they're like, oh, it's based off of this great book. And for some reason, we couldn't get the budget to make it worth a shit to watch.
Exactly. So, like, think about the Left Behind series with Kirk Cameron.
Well, that's my jam, man.
Okay, so tell me, why did that movie suck so bad?
Oh.
Was it because Nicolas Cage was in it? Or in one of them?
Well,
of
Nicolas them? Cage was in the reboot that just came out a couple years ago,
okay.
which I think holds
yeah.
like a 2% on Rotten Tomatoes. I think it might be I think it's lower. It's lower in percentage than the Kirk Cameron movies, which is really impressive. I think the Kirk Cameron ones were like a 10%, and somehow they got Nicolas Cage in it, and it
yeah.
still did worse. But why do those movies suck? Even a lot of the Christians can look at some of their theological ideas and some of the stuff that they're
right.
pushing, and be like, this is cheesy as shit. This isn't even backed by the Bible or anything. That's a completely different issue. But obviously the biggest issue is they didn't put the money into it to make it good. They didn't hire a writer that was there to write a good story. They hired a writer that was there to push a message and to sell it to Christians.
Right. That's the problem. Art first, then that's the thing. I think you nailed it. Great point. I've known that. But I just never expressed that because I was just thinking about it the other day. I was like, yeah, you're right. I mean, I was actually thinking of this, but I just never put it in words before. But you nailed it. I was like,
sure.
hearing you, I'm like, yes, that's it, man.
There you go. That was free.
People,
you can use it.
I'm going to use that shit now, dude. Thank you. Because, I mean, you make a great point on that.
Sure.
I don't know what else. I mean, other than like Christian movies, libertarian movies, libertarian music, for the most part, it's pretty bad.
Sure.
You got Eric July, but it rest pretty bad.
Yeah.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
One of the excuses that I don't know so much about, like, libertarian art, if anybody's like really trying to put out libertarian movies all that much, but like in the Christian side of things, they always say like, oh, it's because they couldn't get the budget because people don't want to see that. It's like, well, if people don't want to see it, then don't do it. And it's like, you also can't blame the budget, because you've got movies like horror movies, like the Paranormal Activity movies that spent like $5 million and are one of the highest grossing franchises of all time. It's like, if you have a good story and you are ingenuitive and creative, you can make good art. You just need to.
I agree.
Don't worry about the stupid message until you're able to make the art. And if you want to be a lecturer, if you just want to put out a message, then go preach somewhere.
I think there's a hint in subtlety too. I mean, like, I think we could do whatever message you're trying to spread, regardless of whatever your medium is. I think a hint of subtlety, it's always kind of sticks in the back of people's heads. You know, like when you're, you know, talking to somebody and you want to throw in like a little nugget or something, it's cool to throw that in there just so they can start thinking about it, because maybe it's something they've never thought about before.
Sure.
And I think that if we kind of do that a little bit at a time, instead of just making a libertarian movie, let's make a movie that has some a really good movie with some libertarianism in it.
Right.
Some like moral, you know, at the end of the story. One of my favorite movies is Watchmen, The Watchmen. And it's a very anti-war movie if you watch that movie, but it's so dynamic. And I'm still to this day confused in really what that movie really meant. You know, like, it has so many different angles. Like, you have different characters with different, you know, anyone of your listeners like D&D, but so many different alignments of moral character. You know, you got chaotic good, got... Exactly. So you have all these different characters and you're just like wondering, what is the point of this movie other than the fact that the government sucks? Well, that was good. It's a very anti-war movie and it's about human beings that cannot be trusted with that much power.
Yeah.
And that's what I kind of got out of it. But I thought the movie The Watchmen is very interesting. I don't think it's libertarian, though. Like, that's the thing. It's like, I don't know what it is. I don't know. Dan, I'm just out of curiosity. I want to know your opinion. You've seen the movie, I'm sure.
I haven't seen the movie, actually.
Oh, my God, dude. Sorry. You watched the movie. Dude, I thought everyone in the world had seen that one.
Yeah.
What about V for Vendetta? What do you think of that?
I saw that movie.
I'm just curious from your perspective.
No, absolutely. I saw that movie way, way back when I was too young to know to even understand anything about politics or libertarianism.
Right.
Which I suppose is not that crazy old, but I haven't really been into politics more than 3 or 4 or 5 years, something like that. So I wasn't really that a kid. Like, I didn't really take it all in. I've been meaning to go back and rewatch it because I've heard a lot of the themes in that movie. But how about you? How about you? Thoughts?
I don't know. The movie was obviously written by a lefty,
sure,
and I don't think he's promoting anarcho-capitalism or any kind of capitalism or pro-capitalism. But I do think it's about freedom,
right?
And I can give credit on that side,
right?
But I don't know exactly where that movie sits either.
Yeah, it's kind of like, have you seen Mr. Robot show?
No, I've
Let's
I've
just
heard
go
of
back
the
and
show.
Forth naming I've... off different names of things that the other person hasn't seen. And nah. Half hour of that. No, it's great audio.
Yeah, have you seen that? No, I haven't.
Nope. Okay.
I've seen the first show. Actually, I lie.
Okay.
I saw the first episode and
you don't have to pretend just to make this better.
No, I did see the first episode. I was drunk though. And sure, that was it. And I had a, yeah, yeah. But what's the deal with Mr. Robot? Just give me a head breakdown.
From my understanding, I've only seen the first season, but it's got very similar talk points to V for Vendetta, taking down big corporations and stuff like that. It seems like they could take it into like a kind of an anarchy slant, but I'm certain that they're not, but let's move on from here because it's going
okay,
sure. What's your take on like entertainment that you do disagree with. Like Jim Carrey comes out and says, you know, we all need to be, we need to embrace socialism, the word and everything and all that. He said that on Bill Maher a couple months ago. And like Robert De Niro coming out and saying, fuck Trump, and getting thunderous applause for that bold statement. What's your take on that? Are you able to watch these people's artwork and consume that? Or do you just have that nagging in the back of your mind?
Well, you know what? I dude, that's a tough one. I would have to say that I can't enjoy, like, I'll still watch it, but I think, but I don't know if I'll buy it. Like if I buy it on Prime, it's like all inclusive. So I didn't really spend money. Like it's already there. Even though I did buy it,
you're giving them the numbers though. You're giving them the votes and everything too.
Sure. That's fine. But at the same time, they have an obligation. Even though I don't agree with it, I'm like, I don't like Trump either, but I mean, De Niro, he's such a bold man because just about everyone in Hollywood hates Trump. So he's so righteous and so brave to stand up. Whatever. Fuck you, De Niro. It's whatever. Dude, I mean, like,
you should get a round of applause for saying that bold statement of fuck De Niro.
I know. With everyone in agreement with him. It's
all the libertarians, you know, silently.
Yeah.
Boobs on their calculators.
Exactly. I think De Niro's a great actor. I do have trouble supporting movies that if I know their political standpoint. I mean, like, I enjoyed some of Jim Carrey's movies in the past. I mean, I think they were funny or interesting or entertaining. But I think it's, if you're that big of a star, I think it's kind of a shot in your own foot. I mean, you're shooting yourself in your own foot because, you know, you have to, I think guys who are, you know, the actors who kind of remain politically neutral are smarter.
Yeah.
I mean, think about it. Like Tom Cruise has never said any political affiliation whatsoever, other than the fact that he's part of Scientology. But regardless, he's never said he's left or right.
Sure.
And I can, like, I kind of respect that, especially coming from a big star like that.
Mm-hmm.
Just because now you know that they're not going to use the money that you paid to listen or watch a movie, you know, for some goddamn Democratic socialist commie bullshit. So, like, you know, that's my thing. But other than that, yeah, it's hard for me to watch Jim Carrey now. Fuck him. All right. Yeah, to be honest. Yeah. It doesn't. It sucks. It sucks for me.
Sure.
And I shouldn't be looking at it like that. It sucks, man.
Yeah.
But look at the Dixie Chicks, right? Remember, like, they were a country band.
Yep.
Right? Like, they were the heartthrobs of the South, right? Texas loved them, Louisiana, Georgia, all the flyover states that everyone likes to refer to them as, right? They loved the Dixie Chicks. And then when they came out against George W. Bush in the war, which we're libertarians, we kind of relate to that.
Yep.
They lost. They went down.
Yeah.
They went down faster than a whore in the back of a parking lot. I mean, they went down quick and nobody wanted anything to do with them. And they just pissed off all their supporters. So in my opinion, I would almost remain apolitical if you get to that stature, that height of power or height of success at that point.
So that brings me back to one of the earlier questions where I asked, do you think that they have an obligation to preach what they believe, or should they just keep it to themselves for the sake of money?
That's on them. They have an obligation if they owe it to themselves. Like, again, like, is it good for their career? Maybe not. And I don't, I think they're falling on deaf ears at that point.
Sure.
Do they have a moral obligation? That's up to them as an individual. I don't believe anything should be mandated. If they believe what they're doing is right, they should do it.
Yeah.
I'm just saying they're fools to do it. I mean, there's a difference. If you really feel like it's your moral obligation to do it and remain broke, sure. Like, I'm sure if my podcast was a left-leaning podcast, I would be the fucking biggest hit on the internet right now. Like, that's the point. Like, I would be huge because, you know, and Dan, you would be too. I mean, I don't know. Mark would also, you know, Mark and Chris Spangle and all of the fucking libertarian podcasters.
There's a lot more competition on the left.
There is. That's what I'm saying, though. Like, but what I'm saying is, overall, I think that you would be it's a better, safer shoe-in. Hmm. You would have more listeners because most people don't even understand what libertarianism is. Sure. They just think it's republicanism light.
Right.
You guys are capitalists. You're evil. It's like, we're not about fascism.
Right.
That's what we have now, motherfuckers. But they don't know that. And
all right, Johnny, you've convinced me this is now a liberal podcast. Just for the sake of money, I'm just going to go for it.
There you go, man. I mean, you got to follow the money. Why don't you talk about the environment or some bullshit like that? I mean,
all about open markets. I'm going where the money is.
Yeah, exactly. Go where the money's at. I mean, but it sucks. It sucks that it's come to this, like where you are silenced if you go against the system. And again, like this is another thing that we're dealing with. Like if you are right wing or libertarian, which they are not the same.
Yeah.
But if you're right wing or libertarian and you believe in certain things, then now you are promoting hate speech. And so like I just said, fuck you. And I decided to like go on my own and start doing these like 2-minute hate speeches as a joke.
Right.
Like just rip on stuff that just pisses me off.
Yeah.
And they're horrible. I don't hold back. There isn't like I'm putting gloves on. I'm like,
you don't even
hold
back
careful.
Enough to keep them to 2 minutes for these 2-minute hate speeches.
I know. I just keep going, you know? And like that's the thing, man. It's just like it fucking pisses me off. And these things piss me off. And they could say all the shit all they want, but when somebody has like a counterpoint, it's like, hell, we can't hear that.
Right.
That's evil. You guys are racist. I'm like, I'm racist? Okay.
Right.
All right, my two daughters are like half Filipino. I don't understand why I'd be racist. I just think people should just be good people. Sure. I'm not saying it's stupid, man. It's all a false dichotomy. Everything in this world is now created. It's all political. It's everything is political.
Yeah.
And it's sickening, man. And we have I don't know if you've been to college, but when I was in college, it was like we had to take this critical thinking course. And I like how that was stated, critical thinking. Right. So basically what happened is if you didn't like say what the professors wanted you to say, you failed.
Isn't it the opposite of critical thinking?
Exactly. That's what I was saying. It's like there was no critical thinking. Like right. You had to kind of agree with them or make a point and really like back it up. But if you went against the professor's belief system, you really had to make sure your shit was, you know, your ducks were in a row.
Right.
But that's the problem, man. Like, this is the thing. It's like people are being brainwashed by the schools. They're getting hit on all fronts, media, school, entertainment, you name it, government, politics, Hollywood, all of it, news, yep. All left. Right. I'm not saying that, like, I agree with the right.
Yeah.
But I kind of sympathize with them because they're the underdog. It seems that even though Trump won,
right,
or like there's like a majority, the culture overall, I think in America is becoming more and more progressive. And even the Republicans are progressive. So let's stop with this dichotomy of like left, right, lefts are progressive, rights sure. aren't. Bullshit. They're both progressive.
Right.
I don't know, man. I think it's all fucked up. And I think we're on a downward spiral. And it's going to get worse. I'm taking the very pessimistic approach because I think we're doomed. I really do. I think we're going to go down in flames and then somebody's going to go, oh, man, maybe we're wrong. I'm just waiting for that one person to go,
right.
Maybe we were wrong. I don't know.
Well, we live in a society where it's shameful to change your mind. Like if you are presented with new evidence for something, you can't go back on it. Otherwise you're flip flopping. It's like, no, I'm growing. Uh-huh. That's called human growth. But, comedians and, late night talk show hosts, SNL, everybody, it's all the exact same joke. Just blah, blah, blah. The world is burning down, punchline, Donald Trump, thunderous applause. Like there is no interesting art in that sphere anymore, because everything is offensive and everybody's like playing this very, they're acting edgy by calling out Trump, but they're not taking the risk of actually being edgy and saying what they really think or, you know, saying something that goes against the grand narrative. I think that I kind of take more of I don't know. I like to think that I take more of an optimistic approach. I feel like art is going to get so, so bad over the next few years as people get more and more scared of throwing their career down the toilet by a tweet that they posted 10 years ago, it's going to get to a point where people are going to start going, you know, no more. Like, life is joyless now. I hate everything. I can't walk outside my front door without somebody thinking I'm a racist for wearing a black shirt or something. Who knows where this stuff is going to go? But I feel like it's going to come to a point
exactly.
where people are going to start going, you know what? Fuck it. Let's say all the words. Let's say all the things. Let's flush this out because we've gone too far.
Yeah, but I think by that time, when that happens, I think it's going to get to a point where it's just too late. I think I'm taking the pessimistic approach. Sure. I mean, all I think we're doing, or you know, the Liberty people. I'm going to say Liberty people. Sure. Liberty movement. I think only thing we're doing is kind of slowing it down. We're like a rock on the rails of a train. I mean, we just kind of slowed it down a little bit, but it's still going to happen. Sure. I mean, I really don't see this small of a minority stopping this majority. And that's what I want to change. And I think if we change a little bit, again, we're just slowing the shit down. And I mean, that's the best we can look for. Like,
your primary goal is to prolong the suffering and, you know, just hold it off a little bit. And, you know, maybe we'll get a couple more fun years out of life before it all goes to shit.
Exactly. Kind of. Yeah. But think about it. I mean, really, no matter what we do, I mean, like I could jump on the left and then just like get it there quicker.
Right.
You know, and like, do we want that? No, right? We don't want that either. So like, what do I do? So I slow it down or, you know, I could try to change it. That's what I'm trying to do. I mean, that's my ultimate goal. I mean, that'd be great. Like, honestly, like that's my goal. That's my rate of success. You asked me earlier in the show, like, what would be like a success to you?
Sure.
That would be it. If I stop the shit and people like got it, like they woke up and they're like, yeah, I get it. It's cool. Yeah. Fucking great. That would be ideal, but it's not that way. It doesn't work. It's not like the only, like, it's kind of cool if I slowed it down. I'd be happy if I slowed the shit down. I mean, I guess I could speed it up so it collapses and then we can like rise from the ashes. But I mean, I don't know. I don't know what the answer is on that.
Yeah. If you switched over to liberal to push the train along, then you'd get a bigger following now. You'd make more money now. The train would crash much faster. And then you could be the redemption story of the guy that comes back to libertarianism immediately after the crash. And you could be the savior to humanity.
Theory.
You would be the Jesus Christ of libertarianism.
That's what I should do. So I become a lefty. I make the train move faster. Society crumbles. I make my fortune. I invest in gold. Right.
Right.
And then from that point, then I become the Messiah.
And you emerge as dictator and throw away all your values.
I emerge as dictator and then leave everyone alone. How's that? That's what I would do.
I'll take it.
But I don't think that's feasible. I don't know if we're going to stop it, Dan. I really don't know.
Sure.
And I think it's a tough question, man, because we're dealing with a world of people who are educated by the state. And they are brainwashed. I really believe that is the intent of a lot of the government institutions and why the state has gotten involved in so much education. And this is why they've infiltrated the college campuses. They've infiltrated Hollywood, all of it. I mean, there isn't much left we have in regards to freedom and liberty. Everyone wants control, you know. And I always tell people that, like, you know, there's got to be a law against straws in Seattle. Oh my God, people are dying. The fish are dying. And I'm like, you know, if people really wanted, people really gave a shit, they would not use them.
Right.
I mean, if it's that much of an impact or whatever. But again, like, it's up to the markets. If somebody is doing something malevolent, it's up to the individual to not support that artist or business or whatever. So like, yes. So when I was saying like, I don't like Jim Carrey and I'm not going to watch his movies, maybe if it's on Prime and I kind of already part of the package, maybe I will. But regardless of that, I am not going to a Jim Carrey movie anymore because he's a fucking commie.
Okay.
Pinko fucker. Fuck that guy. But again,
like, do you hold it against people who do? Because I've said before, like, no, I don't like the fact that he's a hardcore socialist. But if I cut out all the entertainment that is created by socialists or communists or leftists or even Republicans or whatever, people that I disagree with, if I don't listen to any of their stuff, if I don't watch their stuff, then I'm not going to be consuming anything. And I'm also not going to be getting any thoughts that challenge my beliefs.
Good point. I don't know. I think no matter what you do, I mean, it's going to be forced on you. If you go to any building, I mean, let's say I go to a doctor's office, there's fucking CNN. I'm not necessarily supporting it, but I'm seeing it.
Yeah.
So I don't have to necessarily pay money out of pocket to see this stuff. so you're going to still see it somewhere, somehow,
right.
You know? But yeah, I mean, that's a good point. I mean, again, everyone has their opinions, and this is, and it, I also have a little bit of, just a little bit of sympathy, just for the pure and simple reason that I think some people, I said recently, I have zero sympathy, but I think a lot of people do it because they think these things because they do believe it's benevolent. Mm-hmm. And they have been part of the system. Again, looking at me, I was a soldier. I was in the Army for 10 years, right? I have a little bit of sympathy in regards to soldiers because they don't know that they're doing wrong. They're thinking that they are protecting freedom.
Sure.
They're there to protect freedom. Yeah. Okay. Whatever, dude. You know, like, I know better. I know now, and I saw it when I was there, and I started questioning. The best, I was telling people who we should be promoting or who we should be, like, really catering to is the military or people in the government because they know what is up. They really do know what's up.
Yeah.
Like, I always talk to people, like, do you think the government spends too much money? Oh, hell yeah. It's bullshit. Yeah, they will tell you themselves, like, this is ridiculous. Like, we should be targeting them for this messaging. And again, the people in the government really are probably our best allies because they actually see the fraud, waste, and abuse of the state and the system. Again, like you were saying, I don't know, man. It's a tough call. It's a really tough call. But again, I think people are people. They believe in one thing. I think that they really do mean the right thing. I think, you know, if you're a socialist and you're like, I believe that this is the best way to do things, that's great.
Yeah.
Not really, but I have sympathy for right. them because they don't know any better. They haven't seen this. They haven't seen the light yet. They haven't seen why they're there. So I think it's important. It's an obligation, or to me it is. This is why I feel like it's my moral obligation to talk to people about economics, liberty, and natural rights and where rights come from and negative and positive rights and why you're not obligated to give people stuff.
Yeah.
And how taxation is theft. I know people hate that word. Like, oh, that's a horrible saying. You're never going to get people supporting you with taxation is theft.
It's just true.
Like, fuck. It's true.
Right.
Like, it is theft. Like, if I went up to your house, knocked on your door and took money, and you talk to the average person, you're like, hey, give me your money. They'd be like, oh, it's robbery. Right. But when the state doesn't,
I'm
going
to give it
cool.
to the local school system, though. I'm going to give it to the government. I'm going to give it to, you know, politicians. It's going right, to a good cause, a cause that you appreciate, though. So why would you have a problem with that, right. Johnny?
Exactly. Exactly. That's the thing, dude. I mean, everyone thinks it's for a good cause. It's not. What if it goes to their pockets? It does.
Right.
That's the thing. It's majority of that goes to their salaries. Like, fuck you. If you really want to be a politician, do it for free. Do it for free right. and run your business. That's the politician I would respect. Yep. Do it for free and run your own business. If you yep. really want to be there, you really want to make a change, I would do it. If they elected me to run for office, I'd be like, I'd get rid of shit. I'd be signing shit off. Nope, 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 nope. And then on top of that, I wouldn't take any government money because I know better now. But it took me a while. So that, like, that's what I'm saying. I have a little bit of sympathy in the fact that if people don't know any better, but if you're a socialist and you know it requires force to take stuff from other people to get your agenda running
sure.
through force, that's when I have a problem with you. That's yep. when I have zero sympathy for you.
If
you really know what's going on.
I do agree. And one thing that I say on the show all the time, and I might have to change it a little bit here because you're making me contemplate some other things, which I've thought all this stuff out before. But, you know, I always say... The person that you're disagreeing with online, the person that you're arguing with on Facebook is not your enemy. They're just somebody who, you know, has gone through a different walk than you in life and come to different conclusions, maybe been right. brainwashed in a different way than you to believe a different thing. And they're not actually they're not trying to ruin the country. They're supporting what they think is the best way to run the country, not ruin the country,
exactly.
even though it,
right.
I think that it will ruin the country. But,
I agree.
The point that you make, they might be your enemy if you think that if you take it out to its fullest conclusion that, you know, taxation is theft. And if you don't pay your taxes, then you could be caged or murdered or whatever. Then they exactly. could be your enemy because they're supporting that type of a system.
Right. And, but again, like if they at least it's one thing. It's like if they to not know is bad. To wish not to know is even worse, right?
Sure.
So in that theory, it's like if you're a socialist because you're just naive and you believe Bernie Sanders because he sounds cool and he's really hip with his cool hair, like that to me is like, yeah, you're an idiot, but not because you're evil. I think you really want the right thing for people, but you just don't know how to obtain it. Whereas the libertarian philosophy, maybe they've never heard it.
Sure.
Now, if they heard it and then reject it after all the facts have been laid out in front of them, well, then now you're my enemy.
Sure.
At that point. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, if you understand that the concept of you're a socialist, you understand that you need to take things from other people through force to get things to people who haven't done shit.
Mm.
That requires force. And you understand that concept. And they're like, yeah, I understand that. And that's good because I'm a utilitarian and that's for the greater good. Now you're my fucking enemy.
Right.
At that point, it's you know, at a certain point, it's like once they understand it's theft, now I know where their moral compass shifts, or, you know, where they sit on their moral compass and their political alignment. So at that point, I'm like, you're my enemy. Yeah. I have no sympathy for you. And if you burn, I don't give a fuck. I'm sorry.
That's put plainly.
Wrong.
Put plainly.
And mean.
It's all right. It's all right.
Burn in hell, motherfucker. I don't give a shit. You're an asshole. Yeah. But that's my point. And I'm all about peace and liberty and love and freedom. Yeah. I'm not a hippie. So I feel pretty good about that, too. All
right. Right on. Now, one thing that always, something that always strikes me as odd is that all these celebrities, all these elitists, all these high paid people who are paid for being funny or pretending to be a person that they're not, or, you know, doing this and that, they're the socialists and the leftists who want, you know, even distribution of wealth and all that. I don't understand. I don't understand where they think they're going to be after that and how that's going to help them. They want to help their fellow man. Are they doing it? Are they helping their fellow man? They have the absolute, all the options in the world to do so right now. What do they think is going to happen in a socialist economy to the comedians?
I have no idea. I have no idea. And most of the comedians are lefties.
Right.
And that makes no sense. It's like it's going against it. Like, I find that politically offensive. I find that offensive. I find that offensive. I find that offensive.
Right.
So basically, you have no material. You've taken away every ounce of material that a comedian could use for observational humor.
Right.
I mean, you're pretty much limited to dad jokes.
You're limited to Seinfeld. Like,
exactly. You know, it's like, this is where we're at. And even Seinfeld has been, like, booed at campuses.
Really? Why?
Yeah, there was like
what
a
did
video.
He do?
I don't know. I have no idea, dude. Like, this is
like
where
we
we're
love
at.
Airline like, feed. Screw or airline food. Screw you, Seinfeld.
Exactly. Exactly, dude. I don't know. I have no idea. Like, they are supporting the same thing that actually limits their material. Like, it was great in the 70s when Carlin was a comedian because Carlin was risky. He went out there. He was risky. He had balls. He was edgy. And he was one of the original gangsters of comedy because he said the words you couldn't say on TV.
Right.
And that right there solidified his comic routine and his wittiness and his observation about how things are and how fucked up they are and how people are fucking morons. I mean, really, people are stupid. More so as a collective. The individual isn't necessarily stupid. I think the collective is stupid. But like, I guess what you were saying about socialism is like, they're taking away, you know, I always, one of the things I wanted to say to socialists is this, when you have a socialist society, you have a doctor and you have a street sweeper. And when you have a street sweeper, the street sweeper and the doctor make the same amount of money. Why would you want to be a doctor?
Right.
If you had to work that much harder and go through school and get good grades and go through all that bullshit, see that blood and stuff.
Right.
And then the street sweeper's like, okay, Mungo like sweeping streets, right? But they make the same amount of money.
Right.
What's the incentive? You take the incentive out of the equation. Nobody's going to do shit.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to have subpar doctors and you're going to have really subpar street sweepers. And you have nobody who's making fucking vehicles to sweep the streets. Like, there is no incentive. So, I mean, again, this is why socialism fails.
Mm-hmm.
Over and over again.
Yeah, it crushes ingenuity. It crushes the human, the humanness of it, the driving force behind what pushes us forward.
Right, right. That's, I always tell people, it's like, if you really want to get into psychology, you know, here we go. Why do you want to have money? Like, really, if you boil down to it, it's like, yeah, you house, yeah, food, beer, whatever, right? Mm-hmm. But really, why do you want a lot of money? Why do you want success? Why does everyone want success?
Power.
And it boils down to, I can get into Freud here, but I really, in my opinion, I really believe it does boil down to sex.
Okay.
It's like, you want a good house, you want a good car, you want a good, you know, life. So you can meet a mate that you can bang and you have beautiful kids that she's hot. You know what I mean? So it's like, this is the reason why we do these things, is because of sex.
Okay.
I really do believe it's boiled down to sex, and it's, but sex is a great motivator, right? Am I wrong?
I'm not opposed.
Like, you. Yeah, exactly. Like, most people really like sex. I've never met anyone's like, yeah, I don't like it. Not for me. Never met that person.
No offense to the asexuals. No. I'm sorry for your loss.
I don't know. If they're out there, I don't know, man. I'm
they're in movies. I've never met one in real life, though.
I haven't either, man. Seriously, I've never met somebody who's like, yeah, the sex thing's kind of weird.
I'd be willing to bet the most asexual people, or the asexual people, are probably just the people who can't get laid, and they're blaming that on asexual.
That's right. Yes. What is it? What was that thing, Dana? The thought audit. You know, like what is it? The involuntary celibates?
I'm not familiar.
Okay. So you heard about the, so there was a story about the thought audit, and I did a hate speech on this. Okay. It was great. It was basically the bunch of guys, the involuntary celibates, right? So guys who couldn't get laid in a woman's prison with a bag of dope and keys to the gate, those guys ended up, like, they were online with these strippers, right? Or like the cam girls, right?
Right.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, Snapchat, if you pay me $10, I'll send you nudes or whatever. So, like, apparently they found out, like, most of these girls were not paying their taxes.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm talking about?
I did hear about that briefly, yeah. I haven't dug into it too much yet.
Yeah, so, so they're mad at the women because they're making so much money. Because they're paying for it.
Right.
I'm like, why? So now they're turning them in to get money for themselves because they can't get laid. That's your problem, dude, not hers. No, she's not hurting anybody.
Right.
She's just trying to make a buck. And if you're going to.
So you think it's jealous uggos just turn them in because they're mad?
It is. They're mad because they're fucking D&D guys. You know, like, get outside the house, drink a beer, hang out, go to a bar. I don't know. Do something, dude. Please do something.
Yep.
I don't know, man.
Get off your, put down your Facebook and your Xbox and go do something.
That's right. That's right. Okay. And I had an argument with Raylene about this because she's like, well, it's not gamers. I'm like, I would say it is. A lot of gamers are probably guilty parties here.
Oh, yeah.
It's like, I have no problems with gamers because I used to game back in 2000.
Sure.
You know, it was a cool thing. I liked Thief and Splinter Cell. It was cool.
Yep.
One point in my life. Yeah, dude, but I wouldn't. If I was at home every night playing Splinter Cell or any of these games or World of Warcraft or any of this shit, I would not be getting laid.
Right.
While you guys were playing World of Warcraft, I was out at the bar doing a gig. Right. So fuck you. You know, like,
there's not too many groupies for Xbox stars. If
no!
That's a thing.
Dude. Yes, you're right. Yes. So, I mean, come on, man. I don't get it, man. I just don't get it. Dude. Yeah. It's like, get alive, dude. Meet people, communicate. Not through headphones, like face to face. You know, it always works out better. Trust me.
Nice.
I don't know.
I like it. And we've gone down a bunch of different rabbit trails that may or may, it might be related to, they might all somehow tie together. But if not, it's just, you know, the 10 o'clock beer on Saturday morning. It's all good. That's what we do. But
this could be like the cornucopia show.
I like it.
A little bit of everything.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
But, Johnny, before we get into some plugs and wrapping up here, why don't you give your final thoughts on art and, you know, influence and, you know, what your, I mean, we didn't even really touch that much on your podcast or your comic book or that type of thing. So feel free to talk a little bit about that stuff too and what your plans are.
I think what we need to do is start really focusing in on music, art, media, movies. Especially movies. I think movies are really the new thing. Everything is a visual society. But I think it's up to libertarians to actually start making quality material. And again, I think your statement, I'm going to kind of use this now, Dan. Thanks.
Go for it.
Again, make music with libertarianism. Is it in it, not libertarian music? Right. And so I think that's the biggest challenge to us libertarians. If you're an artist, make a song, write a song, have at it, make it awesome.
Make it real to you.
Make it real.
Don't make it.
And then
preach.
Yeah, exactly, dude. Exactly. So I think what we need to do is start influencing culture. And by doing that, we need to start utilizing the arts. And if you're good at woodworking, be a woodworker and do something for liberty. If you're a comic book illustrator, draw something for liberty. If you're a writer, write a really great fiction story about liberty. Whatever it is that you're good at, do it for liberty. If you are a libertarian whatever your philosophy is, do it because you want to and utilize those skills because your message needs to be heard. Regardless if you're a lefty, righty, libertarian, it doesn't matter. Please do it and utilize your skills and preach what your heart believes. And I'm not saying, even if you're a lefty or a righty, you're still wrong, but please do it because it's your moral obligation and you'll feel better at the end of the day. And then once you figure out you're wrong and you should be a libertarian, then please, you can come talk to me. We'll
Then you'll look back and be sad about all the stuff that you've put out before now. And you can't go out to the bars and play those songs anymore, but still do it.
yes, Dan. Exactly. So if you know, like I said, I think it's important that everyone has a moral obligation. I think we should be focused in on that. And again, like Dan, you're an audio guy. I am too. This is why we're doing what we're doing, right? You have a moral obligation somehow to something.
Right.
Right. Don't trust the fucking government and don't trust everything that you see may not be real. So this is where we're at. So this is why you're doing this. And this is why I do what I do. So we're following our heart, basically.
Absolutely. Love it. Beautiful. Now go ahead and tell everybody where they can find out all the stuff about you, your podcast network, your comic books and your music, everything you've got going on, man.
Okay. So, you can find, the Launchpad Media at thelaunchpadmedia.com. Again, that's thelaunchpadmedia.com. And if you would like to hear my podcast, it's called Blast Off with Johnny Rocket. You can find it at blastoffshow.com. And if you're interested in looking up my comic book, it's called libertyforcecomic.com. And it's about a space adventure and about three people who work for the state who find out they were wrong the entire time. So it's a comic book of awakening. So again, you can find that at libertyforcecomic.com. So Dan, thank you so much for having me here, man.
Absolutely, man. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thanks for your time and hope to do it again in the near future.
Rock and roll, man. Thank you so much, brother. Dun, 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 dun,
dun, dun, dun. Hey guys, thanks for sticking around to the end. I hope you enjoyed my conversation with Johnny Rocket Adams as much as I did, and I very much did. He's a great guy. I look forward to chatting with him again in the future. We did a bonus episode, an extended interview, where we chatted about Star Wars and some other weird fun stuff. So if you want to hear that, you can check it out by going to patreon.com/thesystemisdown and signing up for as little as a cup of coffee. That is $5 a month. You can check that out, and I think that you will enjoy it, and you will also get our giant slew of backlog of bonus audio and video content there. Again, that's patreon.com/thesystemisdown, and that is what is helping make this show bigger, better, and more beautiful for you every single week. And as I mentioned last week, we're on a bunch of new platforms now. So go whatever social media platforms you are on, see if the system is down as there. We probably are. We're now on Gab, Minds, YouTube, and a plethora of others. We have an Instagram account too. So make sure to go follow us on there. And we're also on the usual whatevers, like the Facebooks, the Twitters, and the YouTubes and all that. So go check it out. Please give us a like, a share, a subscribe, a follow, all the things. Leave us a review on iTunes. That's a great way to help people find the show, help people. It's kind of like looking in through a shop window. They want to know if it's worth going into the shop, but they don't necessarily want to step in because they know that somebody's going to come up and be uncomfortable with them. This is the place for them to be uncomfortable. But they... They want to do their window shopping, and they're going to do so by reading your review. So your review is, you are the window display that tells them what they're going to get and that it is worth stepping into the discomfort of interacting with The System Is Down. So leave us a review on all the things. If you're on a social media platform that we're not on, let me know. You can do so. You can just shoot me an email, dan@tsidpod.com. That goes directly to me, and I read all of them and appreciate them very much. So shoot me an email if we're not on a platform, and I will make it so. Additionally, what else do we got? The System Is Down forum. You can let me know there too, and that's just a place. It's our forum that's currently on Facebook for all the weirdos, all the downers to collectively gather and chat about things like conspiracies, politics, and religion, and do so in a civil yet uncomfortable and fun, open, raw, and honest manner. So check that out on Facebook. You can just type in The System Is Down forum and search for it, or you can go over to tsidpod.com/forum and join that. A bunch of people who have strange, outlandish ideas, but who have open enough minds to listen to debates and, civilly discuss these things. That's what we're all about here. That is the whole point of the show, is to prove that, you know, the screaming, the yelling on Twitter and Facebook, it's not productive in any stretch whatsoever. The art of conversation is completely dead. We are here to revive it. We are here to be the shock to the system and show that we can treat humans like humans. We can be right. We can tell you what is, and we can also have an open mind and listen to other people who have disagreeing opinions and beliefs on things. Because, like I always say, everybody comes from a different background, a different upbringing. They've gone through different walks in life. They've come to different conclusions. The person that you're screaming at on YouTube or Facebook is not necessarily your enemy. So come join the forum. Come join the conversation, and let's change this world one uncomfortable conversation at a time. Also, like I said at the beginning of the show, be sure to check out the second show in the stream that is the Anti-News, where Craig and I break down things that are happening in the world, and we poke fun at all of them. We give the news articles all the irreverence that they deserve, all the criticisms, and we just have a good, fun, chill, laid-back time with that, drinking drinks, smoking smokes, and making jokes about current events. So if you want to find out what's happening in the world, but you don't want to weed through all the bullshittery of Fox News or CNN or anything else, come on over to Anti-News at antinewslive.com. So check that out. All right, I think that is about it for today. Not a lot of announcements or big things to throw in your face. I will just encourage you to go out, have these civil conversations. Please, 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 please share the show with somebody this week. I would appreciate that more than I can possibly say, because we are making some traction as we get on these new platforms. We've seen some new people wandering into the show, seeing what's going on, having a look around. So, tell somebody about the show. Be civil. Hear people out. Listen to their thoughts. And get them in here. Let's make this thing, let's make this year, 2019, the best year ever. And continue to push forward with the message of civil discourse and human conversation. So that's that. That's today. I hope that you have had a great drive to or from your place of employment, or maybe you are ballsy enough to listen to this while you are on the job site. That would be even better, because the people around you might learn something. I know I learn something every single episode. I know I say that all the time, and it might just sound like, a sales pitch or something that I say, but this show is teaching me things, and I hope that it is doing the same for you. Please join the forum and shoot me emails and all that stuff. Let me know what you think about the show. I appreciate all the encouragement that you guys have been doing. Share it around. So, blah, blah, blah. Thank you guys for listening. I appreciate you very much. Happy Monday. Have a good one, and we'll see you next week with some more uncomfortable conversations for you. Uncomfortable conversations for you every single Monday morning in your ear canals. Until next time, ladies and gentlemen, question everything and stay uncomfortable, and I'll talk to you then. Thanks.
This has been a Goulash Media production. GoulashMedia.net.
This concludes our broadcast day. Click.